بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والعاقبة للمتقين، ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأولين والآخرين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وبعد. I praise Allah the Almighty alone, and I send the best peace and blessings upon His most beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brothers and sisters, once again we meet in a beautiful gathering, a beautiful weather, in a beautiful place. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this humble effort from all of us and grant us the greatest reward for it. May Allah benefit us with what we hear and enable us to act upon it and implement it in our daily life. Allahumma ameen. In the beginning of Surah An-Nisa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَّفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَيْكُمْ رَقِيبًا.
O mankind, give your duty to your Lord who created you from a single soul, from a single being. Then He created it made from the same. Then He spread from them both many men and women. And keep your duty to Allah, to whom you demand your rights of one another, and the ties of kinship. Indeed, verily, Allah is ever watchful over you. The family, brothers and sisters, occupied great deal of attention of the Islamic Sharia. Hundreds of references in the Quran and in the sound Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam deal with the family. How to form a family and to regulate the relationship between the family members and each other, the spouses, the parents and the children, the brothers and the sisters. Acknowledge the fact that there will be problems and issues. How to resolve them. How to handle every situation from beginning to end. And bottom line is, if you do follow this guidance, then you will ensure happiness in this life and a pleasant return in the hereafter. Otherwise, I'm going to give you the ugly picture. For those who deviated from this guidance and what happened to these families who did not consider the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the ultimate solution to all the problems. In the beginning, we're going to shed some light quickly because this is a very big subject. We have a very short time, so we're going to see how Islam regulated the relationship between the spouses, the main components of the family. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ayah number 21 of Surah Ar-Rum described marriage and considered such relationship one of His signs in this universe, one of His great blessings, one of His countless ni'am upon us. And He invited us to ponder on this particular ayah.
وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ.
And amongst His signs of His Lordship and His oneness that He created for you, spouses from amongst yourselves, in order to find repose in them, and in order to achieve the repose and comfort, He created and He made between the spouses مودة ورحمة. Passion and mercy. Verily, in that there are signs for those who ponder. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم called upon the youth who reached the marriageable age and can afford to get married by saying, يا معشر الشباب من استطاع منكم الباءة فليتزوج فإنه أغض للبصر وأحفظ للفرج. O youth, let whoever amongst you can afford to get married, let him get married. Let her get married as soon as possible. Do not delay. Do not postpone. Why? Because it is better with regards to guarding your chastity and lowering your gaze. Some people delay. And it's a trend nowadays. Why? Because of the excuse that I don't own my own flat, my own property. I don't have a decent job. I do not have that much saving in my account, and so on. So they are reluctant. And they keep postponing until they pass 30, 35, maybe 40, waiting for the right moment after they become rich. We find the Quran handles this matter in a very fascinating way. Since we all agree that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all provider. إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah An-Nur in ayah number 32 says, وَأَنْكِحُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ وَإِمَائِكُمْ إِنْ يَكُونُوا فُقَرَاءَ يُغْنِهِمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ وَاللَّهُ وَاسِعٌ عَلِيمٌ. Marry those from amongst you who are single. وَالصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ وَإِمَائِكُمْ and the righteous ones of your male and female servants. If they are poor, Allah will suffice for them from His bounty. Allah will enrichen them. وَاللَّهُ وَاسِعٌ عَلِيمٌ and Allah is sufficient for all the needs of His servants, all-knowing. Very important observation in this ayah. In some other ayat, such as in Surah At-Tawbah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about provision for innocence, He says, فَسَوْفَ يُغْنِيكُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ إِنْ شَاءَ. He will provide for you and make you rich if He will. But in ayah number 32, when it came to the concept of marriage and encouraging the youth to get married, encouraging those who reach the age of marriage to get married, and encourage the society to facilitate marriage for them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if they are poor, Allah will make them rich, Allah will suffice for them from His bounty, without insha'Allah. Without saying insha', without exception, which means that's a promise which must be fulfilled, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took upon Himself. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained that furthermore, in detail, in a hadith, in which he says, ثَلَاثَةٌ حَقٌ عَلَى اللَّهِ عَوْنُهُمْ. There are three categories of people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took upon Himself the task of assisting them, mainly financially, and by every other possible means. One of them is النَّاكِحُ يَبْغِي الْعَفَافِ. The young man or the young woman wanted to get married in order to guard their chastity, to maintain their purity and modesty. This young man may be broke, may be looking for a job, may be struggling just to survive because of the barakah of trying to get married. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will definitely increase his provision. That's a promise which must be fulfilled in the Quran and in the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in order to make the right decision and the final selection, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam assisted both the man and the woman as how to make the right decision with regards to choosing the life mate. With regards to the male, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, a woman may be married for four qualities: beauty, richness, family lineage, and religious commitment. Make sure, in order to have a successful marriage, that the religious commitment is one of the components of making your decision. So if she's beautiful, great. And if she's a descendant of a noble family, wonderful. Why not? And if she's rich as well, and with a religious commitment, please give me her number. So if you have a woman who happens to have the four qualities, that's an excellent deed. But what if you can't have the four qualities? Only three. One of the three must be the religious commitment. Must be modesty and chastity. Only two. Then one of the two must be the religious commitment. That's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَظْفَرْ بِذَاتِ الدِّينِ تَرِبَتْ يَدَاتِ. In order to be successful, make sure that your wife will be a religiously committed woman. Will be modest. Protect her chastity in your absence. Look after you and your family. Will complement your life. Will be your life partner. Not just in this life, but in the hereafter. How beautiful is it when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, المرأة لآخر أزواجها في الدنيا. You know what it means? It means a woman who happened to marry more than once. Maybe her first husband died before her. So she was widowed. And she got married again. And both husbands were righteous. And both ended up in paradise. And she too was righteous. Now, whom would she marry in heaven? The earlier or the later? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, she would marry the latest husband she had in the dunya if they were both eligible to enter paradise. Because of that, two beautiful companions, Abu Darda and Umm al-Darda, may Allah be pleased with them, heard this hadith, so they made a deal. Umm al-Darda wanted to be Abu Darda's wife in paradise. So she made a deal that she would never marry after him if he were to die before her. And it happened. He died before her. And she lived a long life after him. There came one of the Khulafa, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, proposed to her. The Khalifa is proposing to her to marry her. She said, Misluka la yurad. Such proposal should never be turned down. But I promised Abu Darda to be his wife in paradise. Now his life, which is built on compassion, on mercy, that develops love, not the other way around. Because love comes and goes. Love could be for many reasons. But the married life, the repose will be established on al-mawajjah wal-rahmah. With regards to the guardian who is looking after girls, whether she is his daughter, sister, or an orphan under his guardianship, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِذَا جَاءَكُمْ مَنْ تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَأَمَانَتَهُ فَزَوِّجُوهُ. If somebody whom you trust his amana, his manners, and his religious commitment, and proposes to your daughter or any girl under your guardianship, then accept that proposal. Facilitate this marriage. And you gotta keep in mind, Islam does not allow giving any girl in marriage without her consent, whether she was married before or for the first time. That's a very explained text by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whether al-bikr or al-sayyib can never be given in marriage by her guardian without her consent. And similarly, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the sound hadith, لا نكاح إلا بولي وشاهد يعدل. Nikah will not be invalid unless if the guardian approves it. And it is witnessed by two just Muslim witnesses. Beautiful relationship. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam considered the marriage contract a sacred contract. And this relationship a sacred one. Subhanallah, in one hadith, when Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, may Allah be pleased with him, decided to donate all his wealth because he thought he's about to die and he had only one daughter. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, don't do it. He said, shall I give away two-thirds of it in a wasiyah? He said, kalla, don't. He said, one half. He said, don't. He said, one-third as a wasiyah after his death. to be distributed amongst the poor, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الثلث والثلث كثير. One third is okay, but it is still too much. Then he said, إنك أن تترك ورثتك أغنياء خيرا من أن تتركهم فقراء عالة يتكففون الناس. It is better to leave your ears and family members rich rather than leaving them poor, begging help from people. That if you already have wealth. The catch in this very interesting hadith, which is collected by Imam al-Bukhari, is when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, who was his cousin and uncle meanwhile, whenever the person thinks that by donating my money, that's a charity and I will get a reward for it, but if I keep it for my family, that's a different deal. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّكَ لَنْ تُنْفِقَ نَفَقَةً تَبْتَغِيَ بِهَا وَجْهَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا كُتِبَ لَكَ بِهَا أَجْرًا. Any spending, even that which you spend on your family members, on your wife, on your children, school tuition, the fees of the physician, buying them school supplies, buying them food, these are all sadaqat. These are all good deeds. You will be rewarded for that. To the extent that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching us how to be romantic with yourself. حتى اللقمة تضعها في امرأتك لك بها أجرا. Even when you feed your wife, you give her a bite, you feed her, spoon feed her, that's a charity. You will be rewarded for that. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that more than 1400 years ago. There will be a reward for putting food on the table for your family members, for your children. These are all sadaqah. وَإِنَّ فِي بُضْعِ أَحَدِكُمْ أَجْرًا. Having this very private, intimate relationship with one spouse, you will be rewarded for that. The companion's eyes grew wild. They were surprised. And they said, Ya Rasulullah, how could one satisfy his sexual desire and be rewarded meanwhile? He said, what if he were to fulfill it in the haram? Have an illicit relationship. Have a girlfriend. Wouldn't he deserve to be punished? He said, yes. He said, because of that, he avoided the haram and he resorted to the halal and he will be rewarded. Look and compare between this beautiful teaching in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and also a very beautiful command which regulated the relationship between the couple. In the Quran, way before any women rights organizations were established, or human rights organizations, or amendments were issued in 1948, the Quran says in ayah number 228 of Surah Al-Baqarah, with regards to the relationship between the spouses, the husband and the wife, and who have rights and who have duties, and how much rights versus how much duties, and who's superior and who's not. This beautiful part of the ayah says, وَلَهُنَّ مِثْلُ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. For them, for the wives, there are rights exactly similar to those which are against them, which are due upon them. So rights and duties are mutual. They're not only one way. They're not only going one direction. The husband have rights and duties. And the wife too have rights and duties. And that is explained in details in the books of Fiqh and otherwise. Due to shortness of time, we're going to swing by another comparison, which is, while Islam encourages the singles to get married, the youth to get married, and the whole society to assist the poor to get married, form a beautiful family, established on righteousness and piety, you find the following. People abandon marriage in non-Muslim society. I'm going to speak about a society which I lived in for a while. In America, for instance. Why people are reluctant to get married? I meet people who have children. They've been together with each other for 10 years, a decade or more. They already have children, but they did not decide to get married yet. Why not? I asked one of them, you already have 3 children, why didn't you get married? Didn't you know that in Christianity it is not permissible to have an outside marriage relationship? You know what was his answer? He said, well, this way it's easier to kick her out whenever I want to. Why? Whenever the man intervenes in the laws of Allah, changes them, puts his own man-made laws, it ruins life at large. So he's afraid that if he were to marry her, if she files for a divorce, she will take 50% of his position. He said, this is my money. This is my effort and my hard work. Why shall I give her that? This way, I'm enjoying my life without having to encounter any financial responsibility. She's like a guest at home, even though she's the mother, technically speaking, of his children, from haram, obviously. Wallahi, since I was involved big time in marriage counseling, I have this one doctor who came to me and consulted me with his private issue that he wanted to divorce his wife. I said, why? Do you guys have a problem? He said, currently, no. But I'm pretty sure we will. I said, so you're anticipating that you're going to have a problem in the future or problems and that's why I'm a divorcer? He said, yes. Then he explained furthermore. He said, nowadays I have $100,000 in my account. And I'm expected to make $1 million by the end of the year. So I decided if I divorce her now, I would only give her $50,000. If I wait until the end of the year, she will collect $500,000. I would rather divorce her now. And he did divorce her. Whenever the relationship is based on competition, fear, and lack of trust, this is the outcome of that. But look at the beautiful relationship established in the light of Sharia, in the light of Islam. وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةَ وَرَحْمَةَ النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم awfully advised the man to be careful with regards to his duties towards his wife. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم even before his death kept saying اِسْتَوْفُوا بِالنِّسَاءِ خَيْرًا. Take good care of women. Look after your wives. Look after your daughters. They will be your gate to heaven. In many ahadith, we can refer to some when we come to speak about the relationship between the parents and the children. Islam also acknowledges the fact that problems arise with human beings. And because of that, he prescribed as how to handle these issues, how to eliminate them before happening, and how to resolve them if they ever happen. Look in Surah An-Nisa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ شِقَاقَ بَيْنِهِمَا فَابْعَثُوا حَكَمًا مِنْ أَهْلِهِ وَحَكَمًا مِنْ أَهْلِهَا إِنْ يُرِيدَ إِصْلَاحًا يُوَفِّقِ اللَّهُ بَيْنَهُمَا. If you fear a breach between them, between the couple, then appoint a judge from her family, from the righteous people of her side, and another arbitrator from the righteous people of his side to try to reconcile. If they intend reconciliation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant them all success. Not to go to 1-800-DIVORCE, find a lawyer. Why? Because it becomes a battlefield. The relationship between the couple will be based on suspicion and lack of trust. By Islam, it is based on mawadda and rahma, as I referred to in ayah number 21 of Surah Ar-Rum earlier. Worst come to worst in case of divorce. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, الطلاق مرتان فإنساكم بمعروف أو تسريح بإحسان. You may pronounce divorce twice. Once, twice, afterward it becomes irrevocable. Afterward, either he withhold her and take her back to your married life بمعروف, with kindness and fellowship. أو تسريحهم بإحسان. Or let go also with kindness and gentleness. Even after divorce, yes. ولا تنسوا الفضل بينكم. You should not forget that one day you share the same bed. هن لباس لكم وأنتم لباس لهم. Quickly we swing by how, by explaining how Islam regulated the relationship between the parents and the children. The second pillar of the family, the second pillar of the family. Initially we said the spouses. Now the children. Many people right away would think, okay, now the Sheikh is going to speak about birrul walidain and would advise our youth to be kind to their parents. Guess what? I'm afraid I'm going to disappoint you. I'm going to begin with the opposite, with how the parents should keep their duties to their children. First, because they confess. A man came to Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu and said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, my son is mistreating me. He's been awful to me. He's been ungrateful to me. Umar ibn al-Khattab does not play games when it comes to mistreating the parents. Right away he ordered the son to be presented before him. And he asked him, why do you mistreat your father? Don't you know Allah said and said? He said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, I have a question. Is it only that the parents have rights upon the children, or also the children have rights upon the parents? He said, of course the children do have rights upon the parents. He said, what are they? He said, number one, to choose a good mother. So the rights begin before even having children. Choosing the right soil. Choosing a good mother. Number two, when the child is born, to give him a good name and to start discipling him and teaching him the Quran and the Islamic etiquette. He said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, my father deprived me from all of my rights. My mother is such and such. People blame me for my mother. And number two, he chose an awful name for me. He gave me the name Ju'al. Ju'al in Arabic means cockroach. As a matter of fact, some people tend to give their children, particularly the sons, awful names. Do you know why? Why? Because they're afraid of evil eye and bad omen. So they give them these awful names in order to distract the attention. That's haram. Number three, he did not teach me anything of the Quran. I'm lost. Umar ibn Khattab turned to the father and said to him, عَقَقْتَهُ فَعَقَقْتَهُ. You are ungrateful to him, and that's why he's been ungrateful to you. It goes both ways, brothers and sisters. We get married not just to satisfy our desire, but there is a greater purpose, much bigger cause, which is, it lies down in the hadith, which is collected by Imam Muslim, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whenever the person dies, all his deeds, his good deeds particularly, will come to end. Except from three ways. One of them is leaving behind a righteous child to pray for him. It's an investment. Not only in this life. An investment which is everlasting. You're dead and in your grave, and you're receiving good deeds. You're receiving hasanat. Somebody just prayed for you in his or her sujood. Righteous child. Somebody just gave in a charity in your state. Somebody just performed Umrah or Hajj and granted their word to you. So the benefits will continue. Every single time my son is reciting the Quran, if he's earning hasanat, I'm earning the same hasanat without diminishing the reward of either one of us. Every time my daughter is praying and she gets married and she teaches her children how to pray, she receives the reward and I receive the reward and so on. And I'm sitting on top of the pyramid. It's an investment. That's why, number one, Islam does not make any difference between the children when it comes to the gender. It was very common before Islam that people hated girls. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you know what? If Allah granted you three daughters and you raise them properly, you feed them properly, you educate them until they grow up, they will be a barrier between you and the fire of hell. They said, Ya Rasulullah, what about if two? He said, even two. They said, have we asked him about one? He would have said so. In order to encourage people not to discriminate based on gender, not to consider the gender a reason of preference, to be happy when you receive a baby boy, and you consider having a girl as an awful treat or a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Treating all the children the same is a must. And Nu'man ibn Bashir narrated that his father decided to give him a property. So his mother said, why don't you go to the Prophet and have him testify to the contract? He went. Before Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bears witness to such atiyah or gift, he said, do you have any other children
He said, yes. He said, did you give each and every one of them like what you give to a Nu'man? He said, no. He said, then find somebody else because I do not bear witness to falsehood. This is zur. This is zur. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib. May Allah be pleased with him. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib is Sayyid al-Tabi'een, the leader of al-Tabi'een, the second generation of this blessed ummah. Said once to his son, son, إِنِّي لَأَزِيدُ فِي صَلَاتِي مِنْ أَجْلِكَ. I pray extra prayer because of you, so that Allah will bless you after me. Allah will benefit you. Allah will protect you. Allah will guard you because of my good deeds. وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا. The ayah of Surah Al-Kahf. Many people, in an attempt to secure the future of their children, they make sure they put them in international schools. It doesn't matter whether it's Islamic environment or not. They think that will secure their future. They speak fluent English, they're educated internationally, they will be able to get a good job, and they make sure that to leave for them some good savings. It doesn't matter from haram or from halal. They think it's only the amount. Look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nisa.
وَلْيَخْشَ الَّذِينَ لَوْ تَرَكُوا مِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّةً ضِعَافًا خَافُوا عَلَيْهِمْ فَلْيَتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَلْيَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا.
Let those who fear for the faith of their offspring, especially if they are young and weak, that they can be orphaned at any time. It is not money which will secure their future, no. Your righteousness will secure their future after your death. فَلْيَتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. Keep your duty to Allah. Do not feed them but from halal in order to keep them righteous. وَلْيَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا. And to say the right statement. Look and compare between these two examples. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, may Allah be pleased with him, he is known as the fifth rightly guided Khalifa. خامس الخلفاء الراشدين. Even though, in order, he was the eighth Khalifa of the خلفاء of Banu Umayya. So between him and Ali ibn Abi Talib, may Allah be pleased with him, there were seven rulers. But in the history, he is known as خامس الخلفاء الراشدين because of his righteousness. May Allah be pleased with him. He ruled only for 2 years and 6 months. He changed history. May Allah be pleased with him. At the time of his death, even though he was very rich, but he had stripped himself from every richness and he put it in Bayt Mal al-Muslimin to the Muslim state to help and support the poor. He had 11 sons. One of his counselors said, I witnessed his death and he had left nothing. 11 dinars. 5 out of the 11 were used for his funeral. So literally he left 5 or 6 dinars for the 11 sons. But he left for them taqwallah, righteousness. While Hisham ibn Abdul Malik, another Khalifa from Bani Umayyah, left 11 sons as well. And he left for each son alfa dinar, 1 million golden dinar. The same person said, I left to see the children of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, one of whom prepared a part of the army, 100 horses and 100 horsemen, loaded entirely from his donation, from his own money. While I have seen some of the children of Hisham ibn Abdul Malik were begging in the streets. احفظ الله يحفظ. Be mindful to Allah of Allah. Allah will protect you and guard you. And Allah will protect your children after you. Allah will guard your children after you. It is not as many of us think that with the dunya calculation, how much we left for them in this account. Riba account, it will not benefit them. Wallahi, it will destroy them. Many of us send their daughters to study abroad by themselves without a mahram. In Askuda, I get many questions and private questions and consultations. Wallahi, parents are crying. Wallahi, parents are very wealthy, doctors and so on, living in the Gulf. The lady would say, I wish I would have died before that day. She sent her religiously committed daughter by herself to study abroad. One thing at a time, she took off the hijab, and gradually she lost her entire deen and she became agnostic. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, it is not permissible for a woman who believes in Allah and in the last day to travel alone without a mahram of her. And I'm not only talking about women. If there is a proper education in a Muslim society, it should be given the priority. You can't imagine the pressure of the peer pressure of the non-Muslims. It's a melting pot. The priority is to save yourself, is to save your children, and to guarantee that inshallah they will have a safe return. Life is short and very insignificant. What really matters is what is going to happen afterwards. I don't want to take much of your time talking about the relationship between the parents and the children, but in brief, now what about birrul walidayn? The other way around, the children being dutiful to their parents. Subhanallah. I do have some colleagues who are priests. We used to have interfaith dialogue and they preach thousands of people, Christian priests in America. One of them, and he has a PhD in theology, and he counsels for people problems between the parents and the children and the spouses. Every single time I ask him about his family and his children, he had one daughter. His answer was typical. I memorized it. He said, well, she's good until she's 14. She's good until she's 14. Can you imagine when one is living and expecting the worst to come? What kind of life is this? There is no security. Why? And as you know, for many of you have lived in non-Muslim societies, this is very, very common. Why? Because you did not establish the right foundation from the beginning. Look, whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands monotheism and he believes in his oneness and orders to believe in him alone, he seconds up by the command of being obedient and useful to one's parents. وَقَدَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Your Lord decreed that none should be worshipped but Him and be good and useful to your parents. To that extent, it is that important. Yes. وَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا Surah An-Nisa. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Likewise. And in Surah Luqman, ووصينا الإنسان بوالديه إحسانا حملته أمه وهنا على وهن وفصاله في عامين أن اشكر لي ولوالديك. Look at this, subhanAllah. Even if the parents were non-Muslims, even if the parents were non-believers, not only that, even if the parents were struggling and working hard to convert you or hinder you from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're not allowed to sever your relations with them. You must keep your duty to them. وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِمَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا وَصَاحِبُهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. Surah Luqman. If they struggle with you to make you sit partners to me in worship, but which you have no knowledge, then obey them not. Yet, give them a good company, treat them with kindness in the life of this world. Do not obey them with regards to trying to hinder you from the path of Allah or divert you from Tawheed, but still look after them, support them financially, be obedient to them, take care of them. Do not throw them in nursing homes. Do not sever your relations to them. Subhanallah. A man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he wanted to join the Muslims' army to one of the battles, which was not mandatory for every Muslim to attend. And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him, do you have a mother? He said, yes. He said, go back to your mother and stick to her feet. Stay at her feet. فَسَمَّ الْجَنَّةِ. Some people say heaven under the feet of the mother. This is a fabricated hadith. But the sound hadith is when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, go, serve your mother, stay next to her feet, فَسَمَّ الْجَنَّةِ, you will find paradise there. You will enter al-jannah through serving your parents, particularly the mother. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, who have more rights upon me? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answered, your mother. The question was repeated. He said, your mother. The same answer. The question was repeated 3 times. And the answer was always the same. In the first time, when the man said, then whom? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, then your father. These teachings maintain the integrity of the family, which will establish and maintain the integrity of the entire society at large. When we give up on these teachings from the very beginning, when the person loves a girl just because of her beauty, even if she knows nothing about the need, even if she's not Muslim, and he decides to marry, or marry abroad in the West, I have met many children bearing Muslim names, and they are not Muslim. I asked the girl, that's a Muslim name. She says, yes, my daddy is a Muslim. What about you? Well, I'm following my mother. What a shame. You meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a child who does not believe in Allah, while one of the main purposes of getting married is to leave behind a child who will increase your good deeds and pray for you after your death, believe it or not. Umar ibn Khattab, who is extremely busy man, the Khalifa, was ruling almost 2/3 of the whole world at that time, said, sometimes I force myself to have this intimate relationship. Why? Hoping that Allah will grant me a soul, a human being, a child who would say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, to come in the scale of my good deeds. Oh Allah, guide us, what is that? Oh Allah, enable us to follow the guidance of the Quran and the Sunnah of your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. One of the beautiful invocations of the Quran towards the end of Surah Al-Furqan. And it is also a trait of the two servants of the Most Merciful.
والذين يقولون ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين وجعلنا للمتقين إماما.
And also invoke Allah frequently. What do they say? Our Lord, grant us from our spouses and our offspring قرة أعين, comfort for our eyes. And make us leaders of the believers, and we all invoke the same. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا هيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا واجعلنا من عبيدك السعدا. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. وسلام على المرسلين, وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد